One of the highly anticipated events of CineCity this year is the live score that's going to be accompanying Ozu's I Was Born But. And that score is going to be performed by our guest today on the podcast, Simon Fisher-Turner. Welcome to the CineCity podcast, Simon.
Thank you.
I'd like to find out a little bit more about you, I suppose, before we talk specifically about the Ozu score. It seems that you've had a life and a career that's as eclectic as, I suppose, your approach to music, really. You know, you did some acting as a child actor and then moved into music.
Yeah, I actually started in music when I was 7. I was, in the local choir. So I sort of went choir, boarding school, choir, ballet school, no choir. Drama, bad acting, back to music.
And so, therefore, would you say that you've always kind of had a love for music and the acting was just one of the... I know that you've kind of said that, you're a person who likes to say yes and not no. So the acting was something that came from saying yes, I suppose, on that journey.
Yeah, the acting was completely accidental and it got me out of going to public school, really, I suppose, and sort of stopped me from getting a proper education, which... sort of seemed a good thing at the time, really, because I had no interest in sort of academics whatsoever, and I was pretty hopeless. I was dyslexic and I couldn't do math, and my spelling was terrible, and I was stuttered, and the acting and the dance sort of got me away from anything remotely educational, which was great for me, I must admit. I mean, my brothers were both, went to school properly and everything like that, and didn't do them any good whatsoever, really.
For an artist who's been around as long as you have musically, careers like that, they tend to be, they stick with, they're in a band, say the Stones or something like that, and that's the thing that they do. But you have constantly reinvented yourself, from the stuff that you did as the King of Luxembourg to the work that you're doing now. Is that just a drive that you've always had to remain interested, I suppose?
Yes, yeah, completely. It's not just that. I mean, I do like to keep moving. Sort of musically, artistically, I suppose. But also, I suppose it stems from the fact that I've got an appalling memory, and if I actually had to sort of remember what I did last night, I wouldn't have much luck, really. I mean, I find it very difficult, even being the King of Luxembourg, when we played live, which was very, very rarely. Just having to remember the words was rather a strain, really. And I'm just not interested. So luckily, I've been able to sort of move sideways, as it were, slightly forward, but sideways, always without really having to repeat myself, which is a godsend, I can tell you. I mean, that, one of the horrible things about acting was that, I suddenly had to learn lines, and I didn't mind when I was younger, but by the time I was about 24 or 25, I was having real problems. I think the brain has a wonderful capacity to remember things and to be able to repeat yourself, but, I mean, the older I got, I've just become sort of less and less interested in, repeating the same thing.
The marriage of music and film kind of culminated with your work with Derek Jarman. How did that relationship start? Because I think it was, again, you said that you just happened to be in the right place at the right time, and the relationship with him and your working relationship sprung from that point.
Yes, I mean, my relationship with Derek did start by accident. If I hadn't been sitting on King's Road, minding my own business, and somebody hadn't come up to me and said, do you need a job, I would never have met him, really. So that's what happened. I was just sitting on the pavement or sitting on the wall looking at the world go by, and somebody recognised me from years ago and, said I looked at him, I needed a job, and I said, yes, I did. I knew nothing about him, but I was fascinated by him. I loved his enthusiasm for life, really, more than anything else, really. I mean, I had no idea whether he was any good or not at anything, but he seemed a really nice bloke, and I was sort of brought in at the end of the filming of Jubilee, so they'd finished filming Jubilee, and I was sort of brought in as somebody to help make lunch in the office. That's what I did. I secured the job as salad dressing maker. That was my first main role, £50 a week. I was making salad dressing. It was great.
And so how did that go from, as you said, salad dressing up to creating the score for Caravaggio?
Well, it was quite simple. It sort of went salad dressing, then it went driving the catering van on The Tempest. And then when we were shooting The Tempest, we were in Stoneleigh Abbey, and we sort of did entertainments, really. And I had a keyboard, I think, or a tape recorder and speakers, and we sort of did shows. And then when we did Caravaggio, I mean, Derek had sort of realised that I did music by then, and we were just looking for composers, and composers sent us lots of music for Caravaggio, and he didn't really like any of them, so he said, why don't you do it? And also, I was a van driver, and I saw him one day in Charing Cross Road and stopped and we had a chat, and he said, do you want to do some music for a Super 8 film? I did. So I really started doing, you know, music except for his Super 8, which he just used to show on people's walls. Pretty accidental, really, as you can see. I'm sort of an accidental sort of person, I'm afraid.
How was that process of scoring Caravaggio? Because, you know, I know that you said that Derek had kind of recorded lots of authentic sounds from Italy, but then also I suppose there was maybe, you know, resistance to you, you know, your first time on a feature film, kind of scoring this film coming out of nowhere.
Well, obviously it was a big break, really. I mean, the producers were worried. I think Derek wasn't really worried. And he just asked me flat out if I could do it or not, and I said yes, and he said, are you sure you can? And I said, yes, I'm absolutely sure I can. You know, I thought, well, you know, with sort of what I know and feel about music, that I should be able to do it. And, of course, as a composer, you rely actually really on great musicians. You know, you don't have to play it yourself, as it were. So, you know, there are always going to be arrangers and great musicians involved if you've got the money to pay them. And so, you know, we just sort of got the best people we thought we could get involved who happened to be really good.